last, I'd like to thank NDI Biology Department members and Dustin for inviting me. And I have a great experience by staying with this very nice institute. And also, it's a great honor that I can make a presentation of present our laboratory research in front of the young and aged and long range of members. And I think you are, it looked like so that you are dedicating for your summer in this institute by staying all the time, or most of the time, by doing research. That's very impressive thing to me because my university is located in a very, very big city near downtown. And if I walk one street, there are many drinking places in place. So the environment is totally different. But, so in that sense, I'm very impressed. So that today I want to talk so that the involvement of PIG1 and PIG3, the shell-gans-jungle-granule component in apoptosis regulation, but not only in germline but also in somatic cells. So that as Dustin introduced, so that and as many of you know, so that P granules are shell-gans-jungle granules, and which are germline-specific cytoplasmic structures. And in case of shell-gans, so the this structure is can be observed through the life cycle. And one characteristic thing is so that it's localized to the outside of the filament. We call this the perinuclear localization. And so actually, so that P granules are made of many components and RNAs. And PIG1 and PIG3 are members of a family of constitutive protein components. And those are the isolated in very long time ago. So that's, I don't want to say those things. You can tell my age. Yes. So originally, we all thought that the P granules are so-called the germline determinant. Determinant means so if this component is provided, so that even somatic cells are instructed to become germ cells. But actually, that was not. I cannot say that was not, but so there are several evidences that may not be the case. But it is for sure that P granules has an important function in the post-embryonic germline development. So because actually so the germ cells are very busy after hatching, so that they need to I should talk a bit. But first, because I want to connect P granules and apoptosis, I want to remind you what is known about apoptosis. And actually, apoptosis is also called the programmed cell death. It was the study in shell-gans as a leading intensively studied in shell-gans, and so the characteristic thing is so it is already determined which somatic cells undergo death during shell-gans development, because the death is a process of development. And because shell-gans, so the somatic cell lineage is invariant, so which somatic cell die when and where is already done. And also that, so the as a there are, the cell death is divided into three stages, but the most well studied in this part. And actually, so the most impact is this, the core machinery is very turns out through the data from worm to human. And there are three, EGD1, CEDO4, CEDO3, the death promoting genes. And CEDO9, so the death repressing gene are involved. So the bar, actually, the apoptosis is not restricted to the somatic cells. Also, in Sheridan's, apoptosis is observed in germ cells. But there are several differences. Although the core apoptotic machinery is also conserved, the upstream the regulating genes are completely different from somatic cell death. And first of all, so the germline apoptosis does not occur as a developmentally predetermined program. That means, so the germline apoptosis occurs in adult stage, in hermaphrodite gonads, and you don't know which cell will die. And also, in case of Sheridan's, so this germline apoptosis is observed only during oogenesis and not during spermatogenesis. And another characteristic is, different from somatic programmed cell death, this death can be enhanced by stress, especially DNA damage. And this DNA damage signaling process actually is known to regulate the core apoptotic machinery. And so that, as I said, so this is the Sheridan's adult hermaphrodite gonad. As many of you, some of you already know well. And actually, the apoptosis is observed during the one specific the meiotic prophase at 10 stage. And because, okay, please remember that. Okay, now I want to enter into the real story. And this part of the study was mainly done by Henry Moon. And so the first we noticed that the PIGL1 mutant so the show higher level of apoptosis, germline apoptosis, both the normal condition, physiological condition, and also after DNA damage. And to observe apoptosis, there are several ways to detect apoptosis, but we mainly use a feeding orange vital stain. This is a very conventional method. And so there are three areas of PIGL1 all show higher level of apoptosis. As I said, in normal condition, and even after DNA damage. And for DNA damage, we use UV, but please don't think this number so strict, because I use this same condition with the AstraZeneca, the ones are completely good. And so that my condition, our condition is a little behind. We use very, so that weak UV level. And maybe this difference was probably caused by the so the different wavelengths possibly. But anyway, so that we also confirmed that the apoptosis is increased by checking the number of the cell pops. So that actually after cell, germ cell die, they are angered by the somatic gonadal cells called sheath cells. And you can see those sort of the kind of surrounding structures by the important engagement gene, cell 1 gene. And so in that way you can tell so the level of the engagement. And PD-1 also showed higher level of cell corpus numbers. That means so the apoptosis is really increased. And interestingly, so that we found that so this is the hermaphrodite gonadal. After UV radiation, we found that the significant number of germ cells lose PD-1. PD-1 is those are so that I only show the immune stain. So the PD-1 signals are gone, but actually if you see carefully, even in physiological condition, you can observe a few PD-1 absent germ cells in natural condition. But if you so the treat like UV radiation, so those PD-1 absent germ cells are significantly increased. And even more, so that we found that those PD-1 absent germ cells are specifically angered. This is the zero joule condition, and even zero joule condition, so this cell has no PD-1, which is surrounded by MOJP. And after UV radiation, more germ cells lose PD-1, and those PD-1 germ cells are specifically angered. So that's why we believe so that from those findings, we are more convinced that the loss of PD-1 is really possibly so related to the apoptosis, induction. And also, more interestingly, this is for nail gonad. So the previous one is the hermaphrodite gonad. So when we expose the same dose of UV, nail gonad didn't show the significant loss of PD-1. That means so the loss of PD-1 is not the uncontrolled event, rather so the elimination of PD-1 from germ cell could be a regulated process by some mechanism. And as I said, so that in male gonad, shear gonad, so the apoptosis is never observed. So that it also tells that the loss of PD-1 may be strongly related to the apoptosis regulation. So because germline apoptosis only occurs during oogenesis in hermaphrodite germline, but not in male germline, and the level of PD-1 elimination was significantly different in hermaphrodite gonads and male gonads. So that's from those findings, we wanted to know how elimination PD-1 is genetically regulated during apoptosis in hermaphrodite gonads, and also how PD-1 is involved in the regulation of germline apoptosis. So as I showed in the previous slide, it is already known that the core apoptosis machinery is regulated by the DNA damage response pathway, which is very conserved pathway. And so we wanted to test genetically how PD-1 mutant and those mutants are genetically related. That means that we just made double mutant, for example, PD-1, PD-1, step 1, PD-1, double mutant. So the meaning that those DDR pathway genes are involved in the general major response pathway is so that in wild type, so after DNA damage, apoptosis level increase. But this increase is not observed in DDR pathway mutant. And compared to that, PGL1 mutant shows higher level of apoptosis, both the physiological condition and after DNA damage. And so because those two mutant phenotypes are completely contrasting, we could just make double mutants and we try to test epigenesis, so that epistasis. And interestingly, so that in case of PGL1 double mutant, so the double mutant phenotype was not so different from PGL1 single mutant. But in case of SEPA mutant, so that SEPA PGL1 double mutant, the phenotype was almost similar to the PGL1 single mutant. So what does this mean is so that PGL1 is genetically epistatic. So that there are several interpretations it's possible, but one possibility is SEP1 can function as an upstream negative regulator of PGL1. So to study that further, so that we tested whether the PGL1 elimination level is changed or not. And so that, as shown before, the wild type after the living irradiation, the significant numbers of germ cells lose the PGL1. And so that in EG1 space, there was no big difference compared to NP, but in SEP1 space, we judged that so the level of PGL1 elimination was significantly suppressed. So, and also when we check the PGL1 protein level, so that in SEP1 mutant, PGL1's level was increased. This means so that those data support that so that this epistasis analysis that the SEP1 may negatively regulate PGL1 the elimination. Okay, so we also noticed another gene, SAT2.1. And because so the SAT2.1 is sort of well known that it is involved in the aging. Even so that it was originally identified as in the East, but in Sheridan's case, so that if you overexpress SAT2.1, so that you can observe the extension to black span. And but also, so that almost 10 years ago, it was identified that SAT2.1 is required for the DNA damage induced apoptosis. That means, so that, please see this one. So SAT2.1 mutant, so that after there is no big difference for the apoptosis level before and after UV damage. So then, so the first, actually, we made the mutant and we wanted to test the genetic interaction between PGL1 and SAT2.1. So the when we made PGL1 SAT2.1 double mutant, interestingly, so the double mutant phenotype was almost the same as SAT2.1. This means the PGL1, so the high level of apoptosis requires the activity of SAT2.1. And actually, so that SAT2.1 is a very important nuclear protein, so that for the cell to be very healthy, so the SAT2.1 need to stay in the nucleus. So that if you see the wild type, the SAT2.1 you can see in the nucleoplasm and not so much in cytoplasm. But even in the normal condition, in PGL1 mutant, you could see the leak of SAT2.1 into the cytoplasm. And after DNA damage, the N2 wild type showed the cytoplasm with translocation, so point one. This indicates some kind of unhealthiness or the kind of the death signal. So that in case of PD1, that's very catastrophic for the after DNA damage. But still the protein level of subpoint one was not significantly changed in pigmentation marker. That means anyway, PD1's presence or absence affect the translocation of subpoint one from the nucleus to cytoplasm. And also we tested so how PD1 interact with the core protein machinery. And so the interestingly, so that even you see the normal donor, so that as I said, so sometimes you can see the pigment absent germ cells. And pigment absent germ cell very frequently show higher level of cell signal. And after DNA damage, so that pigment absent germ cell, so that almost always contain one the stronger so the cell signal. So because of this observation, we tested the CD4's expression level in PD1 after depletion of PD1. And even in a normal condition, so that after PD1 depletion by RNAi, so that CD4 level was increased. And also CD4 level was increased in wild type after the UVB irradiation. And in PD1 depleted condition after DNA damage, so that we could observe additionally. And of course, the PD1's high level, so the apoptosis was completely dependent on the activity of cell 4. And we finally checked the protein level, so the cell 4 protein level was increased in PD1 in even physiological condition. And this level further increased after DNA damage. So that means so that PD1 is the negative regulator of cell4 protein level and also the cell4's perinuclear accumulation. And so that although so that I all talked about PD1, but there is another component, PIG3. So that we checked the PIG3 function the same way as PIG1, and we confirmed that PIG3 shows the higher level of apoptosis than wild type, and that high level of apoptosis is dependent on subpoint 1. And PIG1 and PIG3 has a partially Miranda additive. The effect of apoptosis upregulation. This shows that in PIG3 mutant also the subpoint one cytoplasm translocation occurs more significantly than wild type. I want to make the summary of this part. So that many germ cells lost PIG1 and PIG3 after UV radiation, but those PIG1 absent germ cells were selectively engulfed. And from genetic and some molecular biological study, we consider set one, the P53 homolog promote the elimination of PIG1 in the DNA damage pathway. And the elevation of subpoint of cytoplasm translocation increased also contributed to increased germline apoptosis in pigment. And among the core apoptosis machinery, the protein level and perinuclear accumulation of cell 4 increased in pigment mutants. And those, so that in this study, could tell a little bit about how in pigment mutant the apoptosis is regulated in pigment. So the So the, our model is pig-gum protein prevent excessive germline apoptosis by repressing cell protein level and cytokine transportation of certain components. So we are considering that the pig-1's peripheral localization may be very important to the nucleus, the cytoplasm, or cytoplasm to nuclear translocation of RNA and protein. In case of apoptosis, repressing SAD.1 cytoplasmic translation may be important to repress apoptosis level. And also, we don't know the mechanism, but there may be a mutually competing relation between cell 4 and pig 1, because interestingly, cell 4 also need to localize the peripheral region to the induce apoptosis in apoptotic cells. Then presence of pig 1 may somehow inhibit the peripheral accumulation of cell 4. So we want to know how this will happen in the future. And in addition to this part, I want to briefly introduce another topic. So that recently we also found a completely different cell cycle regulator, CDC25.3. This is the Sheeran solo oscillator of CDC25. This is a very evolutionary conserved the cell cycle promoting factor. So because of the probably the functional redundancy, so that CDC25.3 has no essential function, that we found that this gene is involved in the germline apoptosis regulation. It means that in 0.3 mutant, we found that germline apoptosis is upregulated even in the physiological condition compared to wild type. And this is just the rescue by the its own transgenic construct. In this mutant, we found that myopic double strand break is more accumulated, you cannot see very well, but the double strand break can be marked by the Rad51 foci. So that if you see that Rad51 foci is accumulated in the double strand break head. So the accumulation of the Rad51 foci means that double strand break was increased. We think this accumulation of the myopic double strand break is essential to increase the apoptosis, physiological apoptosis in polycystic mutant, because the spoilable mutant is the endonucleus which initiate the myopic double strand break. So if however you mean double mutant between polycystic and spoilable, high level of apoptosis was suppressed. That means the double strand break is very accumulated, and that accumulation of double strand break is the main cause why constant mutants show high level of physiological apoptosis. But the reason why I introduced this is we found in this CDC25.3 mutant, actually the pig 1 and pig 3 cells actually were more increased. So even in physiological condition. And that level was further accumulated after the UV radiation. And in addition to this, also the third point on cytoplasmic transfer location was also increased in contributor. Although this level was not so significant, at least in the pig 1 absent germ cells are more increased in 0.3 mutant in those from outside the jump cells, the third point one signal was more decreased. So the as a total, so the 0.3 milton contained a significantly lower level of third point one signal in the nuclear plasma. So in this sense, so that although so the CBC 25 points does not look like directly related to p-granule or structural function, but there may be some correlation. But actually, as I introduced, so that so the core apoptosis machinery, SED9 is so the well known to localize the mitochondria. And the SED4, SED3 are also you can find in the cyclotron. But actually, so that the apoptosis is also regulated by DNA damage. And many DNA damage response pathway mutant and might be checkpoint mutant should be handled or apoptosis. That means so that there are. So the germline apoptosis must be regulated by nuclear signals, and also that finally, so the executed by cytoplasmic factors. So then there must be a communication between the nuclear signal and cytoplasmic factors. So that in that sense, PIGL1 and PIGL3 or other factors which may localize to the nuclear membrane may mediate so the nuclear signal to cytoplasmic or autotic machine to regulate germline apoptosis. This is the hypothesis we want to study further. And finally, so that I want to change the topic a little bit. And so the now completely change, so that and this actually kind of study was actually so that stimulated by the study in the stroma and also the sort of casting work, previous work. But so that it was so that nicely shown that in some class of mutant, so that the multivalve synthetic multivalve class 3 mutant show the ectopic expression of the germline protein in some. Somatic cells acquire germline characteristic and express germline specific proteins including PIGL1 and PIGL3. So this is the so the picture taken from the Tetrolera paper, but so very nicely shown that this is maybe the lagging. So that although in wild type only the two progenitor germ cells G2 G3 express P-granule component, but in the one of the Shimagumi mutant, the P-granule components are also expressed in somatic cells. And so our question was, hypothesis was that because the PIGL1 and PIGL3 are ectopically expressed in Shimagumi mutant somatic cells, so that it may also antagonize programmed cell. Then we wanted to test this. And so that, actually, so that this is the same similar picture as so the stroma picture. Of it. Because actually, to check the apoptosis, somatic apoptosis level, we use the head bar of nearly so the hatch to L1 and in sedomy number. The SED1 is the critical factor for engulfment. And in SED1 mutant background, so that the cell corps are not engulfed. So that's why many apoptosis as programmed cell death itself is occurring during embryogenesis. But actually it is technically not so easy to count the apoptotic cell and for the beginner, actually, it is much easier to check the L1's head part. And in several mutants, you can find certain level of the cell corpus. So that's why, anyway, because, so first we check in the, so that we need to use a cell one background, and compared to cell one single mutant, we confirm that in cell one HPL2 is a Shimabu mutant background. So the P1, P3 are also ectopically expressed in the head part. And in this condition, we checked we counted the cell corpus number. And please check the, so that mainly see the 25 degrees case, because the Shimabu B mutant phenotype was more strong in the high temperature. So that compared to the Z1 single mutant, if you introduce HPL2 mutant, somatic cell based level will significantly reduce. So that, those are the sort of these bottom line structure series that F cell, those numbers are significantly reduced. But interestingly, so that you also, when we also repeated PV1, this level was recovered. That means somatic apoptosis was significantly reduced in HPL mutant due to the ectopic expression of PV1, the somatic cells. And we check whether repression of somatic apoptosis only occurs in HPL mutant, or also the same phenotype was observed in other Shimabu mutant. That is the case. We tested four other Shimabu mutants, and all of them showed a significantly reduced level of somatic apoptosis. And this is RNA. And like Z1 HPL to Shimabu mutant, double mutant. And we also checked whether in Z1 HPL to mutant background, whether the PGL1 depletion of PGL1 only recover the phenotype, or other PGL1 components can also recover the apoptosis level. Actually, the P1, P3, GLH1, GLH4, but not CGH1, Ka1, those are all P-gramming components. A subset of P-gramming components, depletion of subset of P-gramming components, genes could recover the phenotype. So that means not only P1. And so we wanted to confirm whether the PGL1 also function upstream of core apoptotic machinery in this somatic apoptosis regulation. And of course that was the case. So the high level of Z1 HPL to PGL1 somatic apoptosis was completely suppressed by depleting Z3 and Z4. This genetically tells that the PGL1 must function upstream of Z1 and Z3. And so I said in germ cell, so the PGL1 and Z4 may compete each other for its localization and expression level. We tested whether that kind of mutually exclusive interaction may also be observed in the somatic cells. And so that we tested whether the Z4 GFP signal is decreased in HPL2 mutant background. Actually, yes. So that the HPL2 background, not only germ cell, the dominant germ cell G2 G3, other somatic cells express the PGL1 signal. And in this situation, cell phone level was significantly reduced. And in this mutant, when the peak demand was decreasing by RNAi, it said Oracle recover. Instead of the ectopic expression of peak demand, HPLC transformatic cell reduced to set of expression also in the SOM by set of four level the depression was caused by the ectopic expression of peak demand transformatic cell. And tested whether this is specific to the HPLC mutant or not. So we tested another mutant, the insertion, this is also Shimabu mutant. Shimabu mutant's case also the cell 4 level was significantly reduced compared to wild type. And interestingly, so that this is just wild type, but if we see carefully, actually in the embryonic germ cell G2G3, it looks like the cell 4 is the level is reduced. So that's why maybe this may be a kind of intrinsic so the relation between the people and the cell phone. But so that we tested whether this occurs the transcriptional level or post-transcriptional level, so that we just tested the PTCR whether the transcription level is different or not between wild type and HPLC mutant, but transcription level doesn't change. So this tells that the regression of cell 4 expression must be occur at the post-transcriptional level, transcriptional stage. So the, and also we tested whether the SAT.1 is also affected. So the, interestingly, compared to if you stain wild type embryo, so the SAT.1 was not localized to the nuclear region. Rather, most of them are localized to the cytoplasmic region. But when also stains HPLC mutant embryo, interestingly, so the SAT.1 was the mostly concentrated of the nucleus. So the nuclear localization was only observed in 10% of wild type embryo, but 94% of HPLC embryo showed this pattern. So that there is a big difference. So that means SAT.1's nuclear localization must be also affected by the possibly the ectopic expression of figuranium component in the somatic cells. And so that was tested in embryo, so that we use a kind of artificial system. But this so the translocation was also observed in the post-embryonic somatic cells. We just tested intestinal cells because intestine is a big cell, and you can see the difference between cytoplasmic localization or nuclear localization very clearly. But we express SAT.1 GFP under the intestine-specific promoters control. And in the wild-type background, so that most of the SAT.1 signal was observed in the nucleus. But after UV radiation, so the cytoplasmic translocation was observed. But after PD1 RNA depletion, even the normal condition, we could observe the cytokine translocation, SAT.1 cytokine translocation. So in this case also that we could conclude the cytoplasmic translocation of SAT.1 was substantially suppressed in HPLC mutant intestinal cells by ectopic expression of PD1. And also then, we wanted to test so that at the beginning I introduced that in somatic programmed cell death, the number of dead cells never change. So that is one, so that it's a predetermined thing. So that, and on the other hand, in contrast, in germline apoptosis, apoptosis then can be induced after DNA damage. So then in Shimbabwe mutant background, we want to test whether the apoptosis level can be further induced by DNA damage. And actually that is. wild type, actually, before and after DNA damage, so the apoptosis level or cell death level, the cell corpse numbers are not changed. But because the Shimbabwe mutant background, in physiological condition, the somatic apoptosis level is depressed. Possibly because of that, after DNA damage, apoptosis level increase. So this is the similar characteristic as germline apoptosis. Although this apoptosis is observed in the somatic cells. and we also checked whether this induction of apoptosis after DNA damage is subpointant dependent or not. But actually, so that in just wild-type background, subpoint 1 has no effect for the DNA damage induction of apoptosis. Subpoint 1 single mutant has no difference of apoptosis level before and after DNA damage. But in Shimbabwe mutant background, Shimbabwe mutant and fast, so that apoptosis level is induced after DNA damage, but this induction is completely suppressed by depleting subpoint 1. This suggests that the induction of apoptosis after DNA damage is also dependent on the subpoint function. So that means, in several aspects, somatic apoptosis in Shimbabwe mutant appears to have acquired some germline apoptosis characteristic, although it is observed in somatic cells. And then finally, we wanted to check by just expressing transgenic P1 and P3 can also suppress somatic apoptosis. The reason is that in Shimbabwe mutant, actually not only P1, P3, actually many or several the germline specific proteins are co-expressed. So that's why although the previous study can tell that P1, P3 are necessary to impress somatic apoptosis, we could not tell whether that was sufficient. So that's why we introduced the figure 1 or figure 3 in wild type background using a very strong promoter, which is expressed in most of the somatic cells throughout development. We could successfully express in this picture the GFPP1 positive the granular signal. And some case we could even observe that those granular signal is nicely localized the peripheral region of somatic cells. Of course, this is not all the case. And also in this transgenic strain, we could observe in embryo that the subpoint 1, this is a normal situation in wild-type embryos, but after the ectopic expression of the PGL1 under the control of strong the somatic promoter, so now subpoint 1 was accumulated in the plasma. And in this situation, we could find that the P1 PIG1 or PIG3's transient expression can, certainly replace the somatic cell death. So in that sense, that we can maybe say that the PIG1 and PIG3 are sufficient to replace somatic apoptosis, so without any other germline components which are co-expressing signal impact. And so this is the summary, so that it's a time is coming, so that anyway, somatic apoptosis was reduced in signal mutant due to the ectopic expression of PIG1 PIG3 in somatic cells, and the ectopic expression of PIG1 replaced the cell expression in the soma. And cytoplasmic translocation of the quantum was substantially suppressed in Shimabu mutant somatic cells by ectopic expression of PIG1. It looked like in Shimabu mutants, so the apoptosis suppressed, the level of apoptosis increased after DNA damage in certain point and dependent manner, in contrast to the somatic apoptosis in wild. So that means ectopic, so after the transgenic experiment, ectopic expression of PIG1, PIG3 alone could replace the somatic apoptosis. So the conclusion is PIG1 and PIG3 was necessary and sufficient to replace apoptosis in Sheridans in certain situations in germline and also somatic cells. And although PIG1 and PIG3 originally designed to serve as germline specific apoptosis repressors, so that they may be able to serve as negative regulator of somatic apoptosis when introduced into the soma. So that, and also that if say this more in a fantastic way, so that it may suggest, it may bring up a possibility that expression of germline programming somatic cells may be able to provide the soma the partial germline immortality at cellular level, not at the individual level. And that's all for the whole story. So that we want to thank all the members. I'm working with her, she is Professor Yonghee Shin. And also I'd like to thank Dustin and the members of the laboratory for thank you.
So I'm trying to think of how Pivot 1 and pea granules would suppress the SER 2.1 from being cytoplasmically expressed. Yeah. And one, do you see any SER 2.1 enrichment in pea granules? And then if not, maybe SED4 is localization to the pea granule. Maybe it's not so much that PIGL1 is absent, but that SED4 is present, and that might disrupt the size exclusion capability of the pea granules, and then SER2.1 can make it out. Is that something that...
Okay, so that, actually, probably I cannot answer your question, but the effect of PIGL1 to SER2.1 and SED4 are different. So that first, so that in PIGL1 mutant, SED4 level but in PIGL1 mutant, SER2.1 level is not changed. So that's why we just think that just translocation, so the nucleus, the cytoplasmic translocation is only affected. So the protein synthesis or degradation, those things are not affected, at least for SER2.1. But the SED4's regulation could be different. So the SED4 maybe so that even post-transcription regulated or so that expression of degradation indirectly or directly by people.
So as a protein deacetylase, SER 2.1 is also known to act on histones, right?
Yeah.
To modulate chromatin. So do you think that it's translocation out of the nucleus? Is it affecting gene expression to also affect it?
Okay, so actually I don't know, but yeah, it is believed that because so that SER2.1 is so that gas acetylase, probably the histone, so the saturation level might be affected. So that's a SER2.1 is considered as a very important factor to maintain some nice chromatin state for keeping the long life, for example. So that's why it is not nice that SER2.1 will recur the cytoplasm. Maybe, so that's why people believe that the cytoplasmic translocation of SER2.1 may be one of the, so the death signal. So, okay, what is your question? So that,
well, yeah, you more or less answered it. It sounds like it's a little unknown. But again, it's like...
Yeah, so it's like, that's why it seems like the for the SER2.1 translocation is a kind of SOS signal.
Yeah, maybe it's more than just its deacetylation of SED4. Oh. It's also other genes being turned off and on that are reinforcing or exacerbating.
I see. But whether the SER2.1 might modulate the coapoptosis machinery, something.
Yeah, I just didn't know if there's any evidence.
Yeah, for that, actually, I don't know. Yeah.
So maybe I'll make a final comment too. Oh, sorry, Bob. So I'm kind of a big picture guy, and this is why this stuff is really exciting to me, because we have now data from what you just showed us that in order to undergo programmed cell death in the germline, you have to clear out pea granules. Okay. And then the second part of your talk was that there are mutants that will cause ectopic expression of pea granules in the rest of the body of the worm. Where it's not usually expressed, and in doing so, you prevent apoptosis. There are 100 and some cells that undergo programmed cell death in scalenes, and we stop that. And so the exciting part to me then is that the SIMBA mutants that you talked about that cause ectopic expression of pigments in humans, there are several of them are tumor suppressors. So you have retinoblastoma. You have another gene called malignant brain tumor. and you have another one, LID9, that's associated with breast cancer risk. And then we know that 70% of melanomas are re-expressing germ-granular components. 40% of breast cancers are re-expressing germ-granular components. components. And the state of the field right now in oncology is that while we can use these germline-specific antigens to tell you how bad your cancer is, and instead of thinking, well, what could these antigens be doing in the cell? And as a germline biologist, I think, well, now we know these antigens might be actually giving the cancer cells immortality like it does in the germline. But with this, it might be suggesting that it might be doing that or achieving that by blocking the ability to undergo programmed cell death. And then you're getting tumorigenesis and all kinds of bad things. And so is this, do you think it's a, we're at a point now where we might be able to make this more translational and say, you know what, we really need to be targeting germline antigens in cancer?
Yeah.
Is that?
Yeah, I think, yes, I didn't do things so much, but and also the, so that there is a drosophila mutant, so the brain tumor mutant, so in which the junk-down components were expressed, and when those junk-down components are suppressed, the brain tumor is also suppressed. So the, yeah, I think that, but so the, on the other hand, there is the disease like Alzheimer's disease, right? So the neuronal cell die. So the, yeah, I don't know, so the, so that my dream of dream, so that if the, so the, if nice p-granule components are nicely so that are expressed in the neuro, so the generative mutant very nicely in a controlled way, so maybe cell death might be suppressed, but it must be very carefully controlled, otherwise it, so the tumor, then tumor kind of thing, like also Oscar. But yeah, so the hopefully so the this study can be something for the kind of so the medical approach.
There's one more, another big picture question. The link between the cytoplasmic activity of the apoptotic pathway and the nuclear signal that DNA damage has occurred, I think is fascinating. There's in many organisms, especially those around, or many around here, those organisms are seasonal, and there's a there. It's not a DNA damage signal that turns on, as far as I know, that turns on the apoptotic pathway in the germline of a sea urchin, for example, but after its gravid season, it undergoes this dramatic destruction of its germline, and the gonads wither to wisps that exist in the summertime, and then they grow back in the fall, the species here, so that they're bulked up in mid-January. Does anyone know about the PIGL1 and PIGL3 localization in germlines of seasonal organisms? And is that a way to build up your gonad and shrink your gonad on in a seasonal pattern?
So the, unfortunately, so the PIGL1, PIGL3 themselves are probably the nematode specific protein. We hope there is so the functionally similar proteins which may control some kind of sort of cytoplasmic nucleosideplasmic translocation. Those protein, we hope so that if we can find so those protein in other organisms, maybe we may study those things.
And some of them are known. I mean, the nucleators in zebrafish and Drosophila are known that are doing its function to the pickles. You might not even need to know that to address Bob's question. You could look at SIRT2 localization, and we know a lot about phosphorus and sea urchins, and it would be interesting to see if phosphorus localization affected something like SIRT2 in urchin or in thank you very much.